Well, it's a bittersweet day. I'm happy to be in LA with my friends, but I'm sad to know that I'm going to be spending my last day at the Playboy Mansion in Holmby Hills to say goodbye to Hef. Anyway, I'm looking forward to seeing the girls, but I'm not looking forward to the reason for it. But I do love LA, and if it wasn't for this, the reason being here, then we would be having a blast.
For those of you who don't know who Walter Lippmann is, he was an American writer, reporter, and political commentator who grew in popularity throughout the 20th century. I was reading some of his work of past this week, and he spoke of an idea that caused me to pause. He talked about men who plant trees that other men will sit under. After reading this remark, my dad immediately popped into my head. As you can imagine, that's happened fairly consistently since he left all of us. As I know he touched so many of your lives, I'm sure you've been encountering those same visits from him. But this particular quote stuck with me in the days that followed leading up to this moment, and it led me to question why. Why these words kept drawing me to my father. We all know my dad's story. The boy from Chicago who was my age when he began putting plans together to launch what would become one of the most recognizable brands in the history of the world. He was my brother Marson's age when he finally was ready to publish the first issue of the magazine, which kick-started it all. Through his pursuit for truth and success, he fought for issues that seemed to accidentally and eventually participate in allowing him to be an author of our collective history. He spent his life not just as an editor or a publisher or a marketer, but as a creator and a philosopher, challenging the world to be better, to do better, because he believed in a simple truth, that if we can talk about ourselves honestly, even as we look at warts and all, that the ability to audit self and society in this way will at the end allow for all of us to be the better for it. We all know he was fought along the way by many, even including at moments branches and agencies of the United States and other foreign governments. But he would overcome, as he always did, so much so that among the many figures to later on participate in the iconic Playboy interview, we would see political personalities, including President Jimmy Carter, Vice President Dick Cheney, and Senator Bernie Sanders, just to name a few. Whether it was his undeterred conviction to diminish sex and sexuality as taboo, his fight in the civil rights arena, his attempt to normalize the conversation around women's health care, or draw negative attitudes away from the lesbian and gay community, or simply a fight for the individual's right to live the life he or she wanted to live. He spent his life in a boxing match for all of our rights, a task and journey which caused the Playboy brand to be viewed outside of our country's borders as one of the more American brands to come along in the last 100 years. But as I reflect on all of these amazing and monumental accomplishments, what's incredible to note is so much of this happened before I was here. You see, the man I knew and admired while I was a young boy, growing up, wasn't someone I viewed as a fighter per se, but as a lover. Someone full of compassion in ways that are challenging to even articulate in words. This was an individual who believed in doing the right thing because it was the right thing to do. And I saw that firsthand one year when Marston and I decided to cheat in our annual Easter egg hunt with our friends. I was 9 at the time and decided... I was 9 at the time and it was genuinely the most disappointed I had ever seen my dad. I recall him taking us into the movie room and scolding us in a way that I had never seen him do before. He stated that it was the fact that we were dishonest that devastated him. And as I grew up and admired him even more, and joined the organization, what I found was that this value, that he had attempted to drill in following the Easter, that Easter Sunday, was very much in every cornerstone and at every turning point while he built Playboy. I had it all in my mind that I was going to come up here and really deliver this well to all of you, so I apologize. Be honest, be loyal, be happy. Although there is so much more that makes up all of us, those ingredients were at his core. Be honest, be loyal, be happy. They were seen in the work he did. They were felt when one walked into the house. They were noted when he cruised around the property in his slippers, smiling ear to ear, going to watch Keith and friends play tennis, walking into the dining room, enjoying a party in the backyard, peeking out the window while Marston, our friends, and I ran around the property, bothering many of you while you all tried to enjoy your movie nights, working on the company. They were who he was and always strived to be, honest, loyal, and happy. All in all, I'm devastated. I know so many of you are as well. Nothing could have prepared me for the last several weeks, but a wonderful note for me to remember, and truly all of us to remember as we embark down this road without him here, is he always had an amazing way through his point of view of life and through the lens of Playboy to facilitate serious dialogue while always encouraging people to never forget to have a good time while doing it. Still always reminding one to smile and laugh even when events may be unfolding that make an individual feel like the world isn't going to continue spinning. That was his philosophy. That was felt in nearly every issue of the magazine he edited. So to that I say we should smile due to the simple truth that we all lost someone we love very much. And he will continue to visit us in our hearts and in our minds. And as those visits happen, we can be sad, we can cry, but we should smile at the impact that one individual had on all of our lives and so many others who aren't here today. That is worth celebrating and smiling for. That is what he would do. That is what we should do when we leave for him. I started my remarks by asking why a particular sentence had stuck with me. Partially this is because it takes me seconds to consider and feel all the love my dad gave the family and I, as well as what he gave so many of you, to realize why those words rung so loud when I read them. After reflecting on his life, I realized that men who plant trees that other men will sit under doesn't quite include the entirety of who our father was or what he accomplished in his time here. It seems he planted more of a forest rather than just a single tree. And as we all sit under the shade and look around and marvel at what he did while he was here, I ask that we continue drawing inspiration from his well, because ultimately, that's all he ever truly wanted. To make the world just a little bit better and to smile all while doing it. Thank you all very much for coming.
later in the day, I'm going to just talk to some of the people here that I've admired for many, many years. And so people can just intermingle with everybody, all the top people, the stars, or just the normal people. And there were so many stars that had come here, and no one wanted to outstar the biggest star of them all, Hugh M. Hefner. His passing is indeed, for all of us, an end of an era. An era we will never see again. A wonderful era. Thank you, Hef. You did it all. We love you. Rest in peace, my dear friend.
Our family very quickly decided that we wanted a small and family burial, but we then wanted to take some time to have a celebration with the people he cared about and who cared about him. And that is really what today is intended to be. My father was a dreamer, as all visionaries are. I remember him telling me that his goal when he started the magazine was that it be just successful enough that he didn't have to get a real job. And it was. As Steve had spoken, he was a brilliant editor, created the gold standard in the Playboy Interview, publishing the most extraordinary writers, many of them early in their careers. He and Art Paul reinvented the concept of illustration and design away from Norman Rockwell's limited representation to producing a magazine that was constantly a delight for the senses and presented artists like Roger Brown and Andy Warhol. And before the word lifestyle was much in vogue, he created this new idea of a lifestyle magazine, not a magazine around a demographic or a special interest, but a psychographic, a magazine that would reflect all the interests and passions of young men, an urban guidebook that was centered on the idea of a philosophy of personal freedom and individual rights. And he was a brilliant marketer. He knew just how to own things. The Big Bunny, the Playboy Mansion, Marilyn Monroe on the first cover, the Playboy Empire. Playboy launched in December of 1953. And what we forget is that at that moment in time, a time defined by conformity and conservatism, the man in the gray flannel suit, the happy housewife, beneath the surface world, pent-up demand for dramatic social change. That would lead to the civil rights movement, the Beat Generation, the women's movement, the sexual revolution, the fight against the Vietnam War, the fight for sane drug laws. All of that was of a piece. The idea of questioning traditional values and traditional laws. And Hef and the magazine were compatriots of all of those other rebels. Whether it was publishing Jack Kerouac or Ray Bradbury's Fahrenheit 451, or sending Alex Haley to do the very first Playboy Interview with Miles Davis, and then to go on and interview Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, and to publish, and Kitty is here, Lenny Bruce's autobiography, How to Talk Dirty and Influence People. He was not just a trailblazer. He literally changed the lives of millions, and so he became a cultural and a media figure. George Will wrote a note to me when my father died, and he wrote, "Your father was an American original who marched to his own drummer and made the nation pay attention. And he did it all with grace and humor and style and a genuineness that never changed no matter how famous he became or how wealthy. He loved life. He personified a life well lived. As he was fond of saying, life's too short to live someone else's dream." as Al Franken wrote to me, "I'm sorry he didn't enjoy his life." As you heard, he loved games, ping pong when we were kids. David and I used to get to play pinball machines for free at the Chicago Playboy Mansion, and hyper-competitiveness around all of the games, whether it was Pong and Pac-Man or backgammon. And as you've heard today, he loved the movies. I think he spent more time talking about screening and enjoying movies than maybe anything else but one other thing. And Casablanca, which he screened every year for his birthday, was in so many ways the perfect movie for him. The consummate romance and a just cause. And he loved his friends, and he was so loyal too. And he, in turn, was so appreciative of the loyalty of you, of his colleagues, of the people he touched. And because today we're celebrating not just him, but this place, which he loved, which he called Shangri-La. He once told me that when he bought it, the only thing on the property was the wishing well. He closed his eyes, dropped in a penny, and everything else appeared. Everyone here has memories from this place, and we will carry those forever. Because while he was basically, oddly, a very shy man, he was the consummate host. And yes, he loved women. When I introduced Brian Grazer to him at Brian's request, because he had seen a documentary and was intrigued by the possibility of doing a feature film about my father, another project, Norman, that seems not to have happened. After he spent some time with him, Brian said, "There's definitely a story there, and it's not the story that's been told." And I said, "Oh, seems to me the stories have been told quite a lot. What is your point?" And he said, "In my experience, most men have a difficult time having a civil relationship with one ex-wife. Your father seems to have a remarkable relationship with scores of former girlfriends. I would like to understand how that works." Well, I would say some of the most important influencers on his life were women, starting with his mother, an extraordinary woman born in 1896 who worked as a chemist, who was a serious and practicing Methodist, but who would invest in Playboy magazine, was the person on the block where Heff and Keith grew up that the children went to ask for accurate information about sex. I once said to her, being a non-believer myself, "Grandma, you're one of those people that gives religion a good name." He met and married three very special women. And through them, I have three extraordinary brothers. And I would say his two closest confidants were women, Bobby Arnstein and Mary O'Connor. And in his last years, he found Crystal, who he couldn't have loved more, and who couldn't have made him happier. And in this time, when every day we are told about predators, boars, and pigs, he was the consummate gentleman. To women, he was consummately kind. He defined what it meant to be a romantic in his relationships. And the photos in the magazine were not there the way comics and horoscopes are in newspapers, a way to make sure people buy the publication so they can read the stuff. They were an integral part of his philosophy of the magazine, the belief that we are a whole people if we bring together body and spirit and mind. That he was fighting against the anti-sexual attitudes that were so embedded in the Judeo-Christian tradition of this country, the Puritan heritage that Dick spoke about, the idea that it was mind versus body. That in fact, in his view and in the magazine's view, that underlying philosophy was celebratory and romantic, and the absolute antithesis of anything that was exploitive. It's why the magazine wouldn't publish the pictures of Jacqueline Onassis that were taken with a long photo lens, and why they wouldn't publish the pictures of Vanessa Williams when it was clear it would cost her being the first African-American Miss America. He understood and he wrote about how the fact that the United States had not been founded as a Christian nation, yet the attitudes and laws about sex were so shaped by early Christian beliefs about sex, sin, and shame. And he understood that it is not a coincidence that the countries that repress sexual freedom are also the countries that repress women's rights. The Playboy Foundation that he started to put his money where his mouth is provided the seed grants to start the National Women's Rights Project of the ACLU, run by Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and the Gay Rights Project of the ACLU. And those were both way before my time. Playboy filed an amicus brief in Roe v. Wade. I have a treasured picture here of Gloria Allred, me, and Hef signing a petition to try and get the ERA passed. And he helped the women's movement more than some feminists will ever admit, because he was in his heart a humanist who cared deeply about social justice. He quit his first job when my mom was pregnant with me, not his first job, but the job he held, because he was in the personnel department of a company in Chicago. And he'd just been promoted to doing interviews for prospective employees. His boss at the time said, "Hugh, let me give you a tip to make your job easier." My dad said, "Oh, great, what's that?" The man said, "You don't need to spend very much time with people whose last names are Jewish or foreign sounding, because we're not interested in those kinds of people." And my father quit. He believed deeply that the real obscenity had nothing to do with sex, but with bigotry and violence and hatred. And at a time when companies, founders, turned them over to their sons or their sons-in-law, he turned to me when the company was in trouble. Which was odd, because when I was growing up, I had no interest in business, no interest in working at the company. My plan after graduation was to go to Yale and study law and public policy, and my dream was to wind up on either the Supreme Court or in the U.S. Senate. But as often happens, life took a different turn. And in part, that was because he gave me an extraordinary gift and an extraordinary opportunity. He trusted me with what was his fifth baby when the company got into trouble. I must note that I was 29 at the time, and I look back and think, WTF? What was I thinking and what was he thinking? But I believed that I could turn it around. And in the darkest of times, he told me that he slept better knowing that I was in the job. I got to work with extraordinary people, some of whom are in this room. I met talented writers and artists. I got to be involved in the boards of great institutions like the ACLU, and to be deeply engaged in politics. And now I got to use the resources of this extraordinary company to work on behalf of candidates, whether we were doing an event for Jerry Brown or Tom Bradley, or for Barbara Mikulski. I got to work in civil liberties and social justice, and all because his magazine and his company reflected his values. That's not to say that working with him was always easy. He was stubborn, demanding, impatient, and slow to praise. I knew things were not going well when an executive would come into my office and say, "Your father." He could be sly. The former president once said to me, "I think Hef should write an article for the Harvard Business Review." And I said, "Really?" He said, "Yes. I think he should entitle it Memory, colon, a management tool." He was always certain he was right, and damn it, he mostly was. He was brilliant, passionate, courageous, and eternally youthful. And because he was larger than life, not to mention because his mother lived to be 101, we all thought that he and we had many more years left. But he died the way most of us would want to, without pain, in his own bedroom, surrounded by the people he loved. And if there is a heaven, it's a more fun place now. Last Wednesday was my birthday. It was the first birthday in 65 years that I didn't get a birthday card from my dad. The cliche that you're never ready turns out to be true. He's left an enduring legacy. He truly improved the lives of millions of people who never knew him. But for those of us who did, his family, his friends, his colleagues, I think his real legacy are the memories and the love that he has left us that will always be in our hearts. Thank you.
Is, you know, how much of the mystique is real, and is it as much fun as it appears to be? And the honest answer is more.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you if you're young and hot.
And I think a part of that is because it comes from a direct connection to the boy who dreamed the dream. I'm living out an adolescent boy's dream.
If you're young and hot.
And doing it in a very open way.
You can go to extremes with impossible.
And it is a celebration of life. And if there's any message in it, it is that life should be more than a veil of tears. We're here for a little while, celebrate it. And that's what I'm doing.
If you are amongst the very young at heart, and if you should survive to 105. Look at all we have.
You have to. You have to.
Just like being alive. Now here is the best part. You have a head start. If you are amongst the very young at heart.
I've fought the good fight. I've lived a wonderful life, and looking back on those days from a golden place.
It was in 1954, and there was this young guy, this upstart, who had a message for the men of America. It was a simple, honest message, which basically read, it's okay to be passionate. Passionate about sex, or food, or art, or literature, or music. Passion is good. Passion is probably the key ingredient to a happy life.
Where would you like to go next? It was my feeling there ought to be something more in the plain pleasure of life. That in America we knew how to keep up with the Joneses, and we knew how to work, but we didn't know how to play. We are fascinated with sex and play, and feel guilty about it. And they're trying to straighten out some of that has been what my life has been all about.
This is the cover of issue number one.
What I tried to do with Playboy was to create a men's magazine that was a lifestyle publication that included a romantic connection with the opposite sex as part of that. Instead of using Hollywood stars or glamour girls from New York, the Playmates became the girl next door.
It's hard to imagine now, but at that time, that was revolutionary. A real girl. Not a professional new model, but a real girl who worked in the office next door, who lived down the block.
Now that I am...
The American male has found a new place of relaxation. It's the Key Club. The most famous example of such a tight club is the Playboy.
Hold on, little sir. Where's my buddy? Where is he?
Well, you better believe it, because you ain't gonna get to see it.
Everything about the extravagant Playboy empire, access, youth, glamour, money, and pleasure. Is Hugh Hefner's empire a 20th century Garden of Eden, or is it a modern day Sodom and Gomorrah?
We were the first white club to hire a black comedian. We hired Dick Gregory. I asked Hef if it was okay, and he said absolutely. nobody was refused membership to the Playboy Club because of their race or religion.
At that time, black comics had not been permitted to stand flat-footed in a white nightclub and talk. Hefner brought me in from there to Time Magazine, to the Jack Parr Show. When you look and see the role that black comics play and the influence that the Richard Pryors have had on white comics, all that started because of Hefner.
30 years from this year, Negro can become president. So treat me right, I'll get in there and raise taxes on him.
Hef decides Aretha Franklin is talented when no one knew who Aretha Franklin was. Today she'll say that the first time she performed for a white audience and didn't have to enter through the kitchen was a Playboy Club. And that was just how Hef fought.
Well, if you're going to go to the very heart of what Hugh Hefner is really all about, I think it is a search for freedom and, of course, for justice, too.
He was pushing the envelope, and the law reacted to him. The law changed in response to what the people wanted. People voted with their feet. They went to the stores and they bought Playboy magazine, and that changed the way the laws would be interpreted and had more of an impact on our freedom of expression than Supreme Court decisions did.
Hefner said that the Playboy Foundation was intended to put his money where his mouth was for issues that were not just relevant to Playboy, but were relevant to a broader philosophy of what makes for a just society.
Hugh M. Hefner has championed individual freedom and the First Amendment for more than 60 years. Throughout their careers, the Hefners have forcefully fought censorship and controversy over the magazine's depiction of women, powerfully exercising and defending freedom of expression and freedom of the press.
I think what my father taught me about freedom of expression is that it's okay to not be PC when you're having a conversation about something that really matters. It's okay to challenge other people's beliefs and your own beliefs.
Playboy was challenging a very resisting, frightened, hostile culture. It was all the rights of blacks and free speech, all as a part of a kind of movement that Playboy was critical to.
Mr. Hefner insists that there is such a thing as a Playboy philosophy of which he is a part of it. You are seeking, in effect, to annul the traditional code about what is homosexual behavior. Let me ask you this.
I'm suggesting that you re-examine. Suggested that two or three times or stated to it.
Yeah.
It's not true that I'm, by any sense, because the end that I'm seeking is really very similar.
The kinds of questions that Hefner was raising and the taboos that he was pushing back against couldn't help but get people more generally, including women, to question authority.
A lot of people have forgotten that Playboy has published every important writer in modern American history.
Writers, cartoonists, photographers, artists, they all wanted to be part of this cultural revolutionary piece of work that we were doing.
But it was a big status thing to do the Playboy interview, and I think I answered some things perhaps a little more frankly than I normally would, thinking I'm in the big time of Playboy now.
Interviewers, in the first 20 years, you'll see that they are like a classical symphony. One melody leads into the next melody, and the third melody is a counterpoint on the first melody. And many years later, Steve Jobs said about his first Playboy interview, it was the single best thing in media he had ever done.
You, Hefner, really understood the art of using mass media.
Hello there. I'm Hugh Hefner. Welcome to the Playboy Mansion.
Better than anybody else of his generation.
I'm Hugh Hefner, the publisher of Playboy Magazine, and your host. And this is Playboy's penthouse. Come on in.
And he did something that really has been done very rarely. He made himself the company in terms of his image. And it's been a huge asset for Playboy.
Give me the Playboy in Chicago!
We went to the Cannes Film Festival, and he was, without a doubt, the man of the hour. everywhere we went. It was like the Pied Piper, and for good reason, because he is an icon.
I think this man half has covered the decades, and he certainly kept moving around, so you never know where to place him, but you gotta place him as one of the great influences of the century.
I always felt that Hefner was bringing to all of us, men and women, another side of living that no one dared to go near or touch. Not many people owned private jets in those days, especially painted like a bunny. If it was a corporate jet, they tried to make it invisible. They painted blue with clouds so nobody would notice it. And here was a guy flaunting his success in a profession that no one could break into.
It was such an exciting thing to have this plane touch down at Gatwick and Orly and all these places and have the press there to see him, our buddy.
When people ask me whether I ever miss the plane, I say only when I fly. Only way to go.
This is home?
Yeah, this is home.
Ooh, that'd be nice.
When I was a kid growing up in Chicago with my brother Keith, ours was the house where the neighborhood kids came to play. As you can see, nothing's changed.
It is much more selfish than it appears to be. Quite frankly, I don't think my life would be nearly as much fun if I wasn't sharing it with some people I care about. You know, there was a time of innocence that existed from the arrival of the birth control pill in 1960 and the arrival of AIDS in the early 1980s that was almost biblical. I mean, it was like the Garden of Eden, a time of innocence, a time of adventure, and that was infected, I think, in no other place in the same way as it was at the Playboy Mansion.
There are some people who not only make the world different, but make it better just by being who they are. And Hugh Hefner is one of those people. He's a living example of a man not only uncorrupted by power, but a man who over the years has become more generous, more thoughtful, and more caring. All of you here have chosen Hugh Hefner as your friend. Well, you don't get to choose your father. And I didn't even get to spend very much time with mine when I was growing up. But you know, you don't spend a lot of years as a child. And for the rest of my life as an adult, I have, quite simply, the best father that I could ask for.
I believe it was the London Times several years ago that described him as one of 1,000 most influential individuals in the history of the world.
He almost single-handedly created the new freedom to read and think and do as you like.
Hugh Hefner's legacy is simply that he is one of the principal architects of the modern sexual revolution.
I think that he'd probably like to be remembered as somebody who made a difference in his world and a difference for the better.
He didn't go into the magazine business to make money. He wanted to publish a magazine that said what he wanted to say, and I think he succeeded. I'm very proud of him.
As wild as my dreams were when I was a kid, I could not have imagined the life that I was going to be living. I remain in touch with the boy who dreamed the dreams, and I love that kid. The single driving force in my life is looking for that perfect world where the words of the songs are true, where you are given unquestioning, non-judgmental, total love. I've spent my life looking for that world, and it's been a wonderful adventure.
May God's blessing keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. May you stay.
Half one said, I could not have imagined a sweeter life. Well, we hope he's in a better place, but I'm not sure that's possible.
He's looking at you, kid.